Bismillah. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Wassalatu wassalam ala Rasul al-Kareem wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man tabi'a sunnatahu ila yawmiddin. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome again to another episode of your weekly Islamic chat show, Live by Islam. I'm your host Ismail Buluk, and today we want to talk about something which is a very important topic. In fact, it's probably one of the most important topics, as we're going to be talking about the Quran, which is, as we know, should be our guide for life, should be a book that we read, and should be a book that we try to reflect upon and implement in our daily lives. The fact that it is the final revelation from the Creator Allah. And to do that with me is Brother Ustadh AbdulRahman Hassan. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullah.
JazakAllah khair for coming on.
JazakAllah khair for having me.
Visiting a guest from the UK.
BarakAllahu.
Now, as I mentioned in the start, we want to talk about the Quran, about pondering upon the Quran. And I'm sure you're going to mention some of these, but we know that there are, you know, so many verses and so many things that point to the fact that the Quran was revealed to reflect upon, to ponder upon, to contemplate on, not just to memorize and read, but to benefit from it and try to implement it in our lives.
Naam, alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, lahu alhamdul hasan, wa thana'u jameel, wa shadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lah, yaqulu al-haqqa wa huwa yahdi sabeel, wa shadu anna sayyidina wa nabiyyina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa ashabihi wa attabi'ina lahum bi ihsanin ila yawmi din ama ba'd. Naam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in many places in the Quran, He says, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا. In another ayah, He says, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. So here Allah is asking a question. And the ulama here, they say this is istifhamun, and a question, but it's a taqreer. Allah is trying to affirm something in the question, which is that you should ponder over the Quran. And that should be something a mu'min does. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right after that, He says in the first ayah that I mentioned, أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا, or are there locks on their hearts? Because a person who doesn't ponder on the Quran has not come with the ultimate reason why the Quran was sent down. كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِ, a book which is blessed, in which we have sent down it for it to be pondered over. So anybody who reads the Quran and just comes with the recitation has not come with the reason and the purpose in why Allah sent down the Quran subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is for it to be pondered over.
And that, I mean, that the first verse is quite profound if you think about it, because, you know, it's saying, do they not ponder or reflect upon the Quran, or are their hearts like sealed, or do they have a lock on their hearts? So that's quite a serious thing. So some people may think it's not that, you know, okay, I read the Quran, I recite it, I have got no idea what it really means, but that's not a big thing. But we can see here that it is a big thing. And it's something that the viewers should reflect on, this alone, the fact that if you are of those who are not pondering upon the Quran, not taking heed from it, and many of you may even understand it, but you're just not taking heed, it's not affecting you, it's not making a change in the way you behave, in the way you worship, in the way you act, then being of those, you may be of those who have a lock on your heart, and that's not a category that you know anybody wants to be amongst.
ولذلك الشيخ محمد أمير الشقيطي رحمه الله says in that same verse, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا. He says that the أَمْ in this verse, it's not a question, or it's not, as we would say in translation, or. Rather, what Allah is saying is, rather, there are locks on their hearts.
Just like an affirmation, basically.
Na'am, Allah is trying to actually say that those who are not pondering on the Qur'an, there are locks on their hearts. And when we say that ponder on the Qur'an, and understand what's in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we're not saying that you have to understand it like the ulama al-kibar and the mujtahideen and the scholars of tafsir like Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, Ibn Abi Hatim, Ibn Kathir and others. The way that they pondered on the Quran and they understood it, we're not saying that every single person has to have the pondering of the Quran to that level. Now, they had another level of understanding of the book of Allah. But what we're saying is that you understand the ultimate meaning in the verses, and the ultimate intent that the Quran has. And so the Quran has an objective. لذلك Ibn al-Qayyim in his kitab al-Tibyan, he mentions that the Quran's maqasid, the objectives of the Quran are three. The first one is تقرير العقيدة والتوحيد الصحيحة. That the Quran has come to establish a tawheed and the correct aqeedah. So that we understand that. The second is that the Quran came to establish التقرير الحلال والحرام, to establish what is halal and what is haram. And last but not least, it is to tell us the qisas, lessons in the previous nations that came. And in each and every one of them, when Allah mentions them, He says to us after it, لِيَذَّكَّرَ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ, that these verses have come down so those who are wise, those who are educated, those who are intellectual, that they can take lessons from it. So many people who you see that can't ponder over the Quran don't understand the objectives of the Quran. When you come across a verse that's talking about al-aqidah and tawheed, you need to understand that these verses are pertaining to matters of aqidah. When it comes to the chapters or the verses that are talking about al-halal wal-haram, you now need to know that what is required from you is implementation, and that you're pondering on it from that angle. Also, when Allah tells you stories of the previous nations, and after that Allah mentions subhanahu wa ta'ala their final outcome, the consequences of their actions, and how Allah destroyed them when they went against His command, and He blessed those who He blessed who followed Allah's command, again it's a lesson for you to ponder. So the person with understanding the maqasid of the Quran can have inshallah ta'ala a powerful ability to ponder on the Quran. Now,
You mentioned subhanAllah about some of, for example, the stories, and we know that some of the verses and some of those stories were revealed as well to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, like, you know, for him, like about Musa alayhi salam, to show the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that, you know, you're going to go through trials, but the prophets before you have had trials. So if someone like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who's the best of mankind, with the strongest of faith, the strongest of iman, has surahs revealed to help him, you could say, learn a lesson, or to give him support, moral support, then even more so we need to reflect on these kind of stories and lessons.
نعم, Allah says subhanahu wa ta'ala, لَقَدْ كَانَ فِي قَصَصِهِمْ عِبْرَةً لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ مَا كَانَ حَدِيثًا يُفْتَرَى. These verses, these surahs that we're mentioning, there are lessons in it. It's not just a mere story Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving, or it's not a lie that Allah made up. So these are lessons. Isa ibn Maryam's birth is a lesson for every Muslim. Nabiullah Zakariya, when he was looking after Maryam, and how it all happened, it's a lesson for the believer. Ibrahim, when he says, Rabbi inni askantu min dhurriyati biwadin ghayri dhi zar'in 'inda baytika al-muharram, Rabbana liyuqima as-salah. It's a lesson. When you look at the man who went against the command of Allah, watlu 'alayhim naba alladhi ataynahu ayatina fansalakha minha fa'atba'ahu ash-shaytanu fakana min al-ghawin walau shi'na la rafa'nahu biha walakinahu akhlada ila al-ardi wattaba'a hawa. Allah gave him the Quran, or Allah gave him the book, he turned away from it. He chose the worldly glamours and the glitters of this dunya. There's a lesson in all of this, how Allah destroyed him. فَمَثَلُ كَمَثَلِ الْكَلْبِ إِنْ تَحْمِلْ عَلَيْهِ يَلْهَثْ أَوْ تَتْرُكُ يَلْهَثْ ذَلِكَ مَثَلُ الْقَوْمِ الَّذِينَ كَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ فَقُصُصِ الْقَصَصَ. Like, tell them these stories, Muhammad. Let them learn from these stories and these so the Quran, as I said before, it is full of lessons for the believers. ولذلك الشيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية, he says in his great book أصول تفسير, he says that every speech a person speaks, the intention behind it is that it's understood what he's trying to say. If the Prime Minister talks today, he gives a clear instruction to the country, everyone needs to listen to what he's saying. If a law is being passed, you listen to it attentively. The same is with the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ولذلك ابن جرير الطبري said عجبت لقوم يقرؤون القرآن. I'm amazed with a group of people who read the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَلَا يَلْتَذُّ بِهِ, and they are not enjoying its recitation. How are they going to read a book in which they don't enjoy it? This Qur'an is so powerful that if Allah was to send it down on a mountain, لَوْ أَنزَلْنَا هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ عَلَى جَبَلٍ لَرَأَيْتَهُ خَاشِعًا مُتَصَدِّعًا مِنْ خَشْيَةِ اللَّهِ وَتِلْكَ الْأَمْثَالُ نَضْرِبُهَا لِلنَّاسِ. Allah tells us this Qur'an, that if it was to send it down on a mountain, it would crumble. ولذلك there's a great noble imam, his name is Amr ibn Murrah ibn Abi Hatim, brings it in his tafsir بسند صحيح, with a chain of narration which is authentic, in surah al-Ankabut, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says وتلك الأمثال نضربها للناس وما يعقلها إلا العالمون. And Allah says in this verse, we give examples and we give parables, وما يعقلها, no one ponders on it and understands it and digests it, إلا العالمون, except those who have knowledge. Amr ibn Murrah said, whenever I read a verse in the Quran and I don't understand what is meant in it, I mean, what's the meaning in it, بكيت على نفسي, I cry on myself. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving me a lesson here and I'm unable to understand it. So it's very powerful that a person, he gives time understand the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is his cure, his salvation, his prosperity is connected to it.
Well, before we go into some of the ways, and possibly you can also discuss some of the things that prevent you from pondering upon the Quran, before we now, Brother AbdulRahman Hassan, we've got about maybe 7 or 8 minutes left of today's episode. We want to talk about what are the ways that people can ponder on the Quran. Well, obviously we mentioned, you know, very briefly, but we want to give them, maybe you could say, like a set of things that they can do to improve the them pondering on the Quran, and then maybe just towards the end we can talk about things that will prevent someone being able to ponder upon the Quran.
Now, what we have to understand is that the pondering of the Quran, or the tadabbur of the Quran, it stands on two basic pillars. The first one is a tafakkur, which is to think over it, observe the verses, and we've already spoken about that part, which is that the Quran is categorized into three, which is that it's Tawheed and Aqeedah Sahihah, in which it establishes Masail al-Ahkam, where it talks about Al-Halal wal-Haram, and third, which is Qisas, stories. That's just the first part, which is the tafakkur, when you're pondering and you're thinking over the verses. But the Quran involves another part, or the word tadabbur involves another part, which is Al-Amal, implementation. And when the person reads the Quran with that thought in their mind, which is that they need to implement the Quran, and that they need to understand what Allah is subhanahu wa ta'ala into implementing it, the whole way that you read the Quran is different. So each verse you're looking at it, I personally need to change. وَلِذَلِكَ مُجَاهِدِ ibn Jabrin, when it came to the ayah, يَتُلُونَهُ حَقَّ تِلَاوَتِي, that they recite the Quran, حَقَّ تِلَاوَتِي, the way it deserves to be recited, he said, "A," it means, يَعْمَلُونَ بِهِ, that they implement it. So the first one is, when you're reading the Quran, you're not reading it because you want to use it against somebody else. You don't read it because you want to find deficiency in the Quran. You don't read the Quran because linguistically it's so amazing and the power in it. You have to read the Quran so you can firstly implement it. And that's what it means by at-tadabbur. Also, the second thing is that the person needs to enhance the Arabic language and learn the Arabic language. By learning the Arabic language, a person is able to go directly to the Quran, because the Quran is in the Arabic language. Allah chose it. وَإِنَّهُ لَتَنْزِيلُ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ نَزَلَ بِهِ الرُّوحُ الْأَمِينَ عَلَىٰ قَلْبِكَ لِتَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُنذِرِينَ بِلِسَانٍ عَرَبِيٍّ مُبِينٍ. That the Arabic language is what the language that the Quran was sent down on. So if a person doesn't know the Arabic language, that them understanding the eloquency in the Quran is very far.
But I mean, it's fair to say that while they're going on that learning step, that they should obviously take a translation of the meanings, and they should, as much as they can, learn from that, because we know that, you know, the Sahaba used to say that they would memorize 10 verses, understand them, and then go on to the next 10. So that's also important for them, that in the meantime, don't just put it off and say, well, once I've learned Arabic, which could take many years, they should at least in the meantime, as much as they can, read from the translations at least.
Which is what gives you the understanding of the Quran and having. But that being said, which is the importance of looking at the translation and the English language. But the English language is an understanding of a person's explanation. So this is what a person believes the verse means. When I explain a verse to you, is my belief, my aqidah is reflecting off the translation of the verse. So it's also in very, very vital import. Like Dar es Salaam for Lillahi alhamdulillah minna, their translation of the Quran is very good. If somebody reads that, they will get a very good understanding of it.
Because obviously we have some translations out there that should generally be avoided. I'm trying to remember the one that comes to my mind. One of the very famous translations, which the translator interpolated some of his own beliefs into it. I'm trying to think of the, subhanAllah, it's just completely slipped my mind. It's one of the most famous ones that people like to read out there, but I just can't, it just slips my mind right now which one it is. But it is what, you know, so the best thing to do is, like you said, stick to the Dar es Salaam or the ones that are coming.
The from international the, one, is it good?
From the King Fahad, for example, those kind of ones. Those ones. I've heard that people say that the Sahih International is easier to read. And as far as I know, if you're going straight for the translation, now, unfortunately, there's some organizations, they do their own copy of that print and they add an introduction and stuff. That's a different story. But I think that's Abdullah Yusuf Ali was the one I was referring to. Okay. His translation is the one where he interpolates a lot of things. So he'll explain a lot of the verses about Allah's sifat or Allah's attributes as they're not really this, and he gives his own explanation to what they are and lots of other things. But like you said, the Darussalam is a really good one to go by.
Even now, that what they've done is alhamdulillah, they took the kitab al-isbah al-munir by Sheikh Safiur Rahman al-Muarkafuri. He summarized Tafsir al-Kathir. So what they did now is they translated it into English. So if a person also uses that translation and a little explanation that they used of Ibn Kathir, is also something that a person would. ولذلك, if you do study the Arabic language, Tafsir Ibn Kathir is an amazing kitab, which is jam, summarized, very good. Some people, it might be hard for them because of the fact that Ibn Kathir brings many of the asanid, hadith with his chains and etc. And it does need a lot of sciences for you to understand it. The Sheikh Abdulrahman Nasir is Sa'udi's tafsir.
I was going to say if that's hard, then they can start off with
Sa'udi's tafsir. Some of the mashayikh and the talabat al-ilm I knew, what they used to do was that tafsir ibn Sheikh Abdulrahman Nasir Sa'udi, they would finish it every single month. Like every day they would do one juz. Before they go to sleep, they'll read one juz and go to sleep. And then that every single month, Sheikh Abdulrahman Nasir Sa'udi's tafsir is what they finish. And this is something a person should also basically train themselves to come with. ولذلك الإمام الشاطبي says a very powerful statement. He says وَإِنَّ كِتَابَ اللَّهِ أَوْسَعُ شَافِعٍ وَأَغْنَى غَنَاءٍ وَاهِبًا مُتَفَضِّلٍ. The Quran is the greatest intercessor. وَإِنَّ كِتَابَ اللَّهِ أَوْسَعُ شَافِعٍ وَأَغْنَى غَنَاءٍ وَاهِبًا مُتَفَضِّلٍ وَخَيْرُ جَلِيسٍ لَا يُمَلُّ حَدِيثُهُ وَتَرْدَادُهُ يَزْدَادُ فِيهِ تَجَمُّلًا. That the Quran is the greatest thing that's going to intercede for you. But it's only going to intercede for you once you've come with its understanding, once you've come with its implementation, once you've enhanced yourself in knowing this book. ولذلك Muhammad al-Amin al-Shaqiti used to say that if a person wants the success of this world, من أراد الدنيا والآخرة فليتعلم كتاب الله. Let him look for the knowledge of the, let him look at it through the Quran.
Now we've got about literally 2 minutes left. So in these last final 2 minutes, maybe we can quickly run through, at least the main things that would stop you from pondering on the Quran. So the person can then look at themselves and say, hang on a second, you know, some of those things that Ustadh Abdulrahman mentioned, I do those things, or I'm suffering from those things. Now I understand why I can't ponder.
Now, the first one is no doubt, you know, sins. They darken your heart. And so you can't see the nur and the light in the Quran. لذلك الشافعي وجد يسي شكوت إلى وكيع بسوء حفظي فأرشدني إلى ترك المعاصي وقال إن العلم نور ونور الله لا يهدى لعاصي. Now I complained to my teacher وكيع بن جراح الرؤاسي. I complained to him. And when I complained to him, I told him about my bad memorization. This is الشافعي رحمه الله تعالى. And he advised me, he said to me, leave of sins because sin, it is extinguishes the light of the deen, the Quran and the Sunnah. So anybody who sins, كَلَّا بَلْ رَانَ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ مَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ. When the heart becomes darkened, every verse that's coming doesn't apply to you. لَا يَعْرِفُ مَعْرُوفًا وَلَا يُنْكِرُ مُنْكَرًا. The person can't see the good that's in the Quran, the treasures and the gems that are in it. And he can't follow what's being told for him to follow. So staying away from sins, I think it's one of the biggest reasons why people can't see the verses. And as Allah said in the Quran, إِنَّهَا لَا تَعْمَ الْأَبْصَارِ وَلَكِنْ تَعْمَ الْقُلُوبُ الَّتِي فِي الصُّدُورِ. That it's not your eyes that become blind, it's really the heart. So they can't even see the what's in the Quran. And if you look at the kuffar of Quraysh, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that they can't understand, وَجَعَلْنَا عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ أَكِنَّةً أَنْ يَفْقَهُوهُ وَفِي أَذَانِهِمْ وَقْرًا. That they can't understand what Allah is saying to them is because there's seals on their hearts. That's why Allah says subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Well, we've come to the end of today's episode. Jazakallah khair for coming on again. And also to the viewers, may Allah reward you for tuning in. Please tune in, inshallah, same time, same place, next week. And as always, I leave you with the greetings of Islam. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.